Good afternoon to everybody. So now we are going to start the AUKUS seminar on militarization of Asia and Pacific region. So first of all, allow me to welcome our panelists and the participants of this webinar. Today we are going to discuss about the newly established, really 50 days old, new military pact, AUKUS, a pact among, as name itself speaks, Australia, United Kingdom and USA. Understanding the importance of this AUKUS, Peace and Solidarity Organization of Sri Lanka decided to hold this webinar with the consultation of World Peace Council. For that, we invited very important and serious organization of the world peace movement to evaluate the impact of this new AUKUS pact. Before I introduce our panelists, I would like to mention few housekeeping information about the today's webinar content. So today, our agenda will be like this. There will be a short video presentation on AUKUS. Then there will be an introductory speech by Peace and Solidarity Organization of Sri Lanka. Then we will start the speeches of the main four speakers, and each speaker will get 12 to 15 minutes time. Then we will move to the session of the participants, where you can ask questions, make comments, and answers. And then the panelists can read the answers. So we will have around 30 minutes for this session and then vote of thanks. So before we start the seminar, I have to mention few important housekeeping announcements, comrades, especially for the participants. First, except the speakers, participants' mics will be muted by the host until the questions and answers session start. The host will unmute your mics at the beginning of the Q&A session. The second point, if any participant having technical problems, which are common in Zoom meetings, please inform it directly to the host. Don't send it to everyone. Don't send your message to everyone. Please inform it directly to the host. By doing this, we can avoid any disturbances to the participants and the speaker. Third point, don't send your questions and comments during the speeches. You can please send your questions and comments after the 4-minute speech. And finally, we have to conclude the webinar within 2 hours. Now it's around, in Sri Lankan time, it's around 6 past 13, like that. So by 8, maximum 8:10, we have to finish, because some of the panelists who are joining with us, for them it's very, very late night, especially for Australia. It's now around 11:45 p.m. So these are the important housekeeping announcements. Now I have the privilege to introduce our main panelists. First, I would like to introduce Comrade Iraklis Tsavdaridis. He is the Executive Secretary of the World Peace Council. And we welcome you, Comrade, very warmly. I would like to introduce Comrade Romina.
Many greetings. Welcome.
Thank you, Comrade. And second, we would like to introduce Comrade Romina Beitseen, Secretary of Campaign for International Cooperation and Disarmament, CICD Australia. We welcome you, Comrade. Right. Then third, we would like to welcome Comrade Harchand, Singh, Deputy General Secretary of All India Peace and Solidarity Organization, APSO. We welcome you, Comrade.
Thank you very much.
And then Comrade Ajamu Baraka, Secretariat Member of the US Peace Council and the National Organizer of the Black Alliance of Peace in United States of America. We welcome you, Comrade, also.
My pleasure to be here.
Yes, thank you, Comrade. And here I would like to mention a few lines for the information of our participants about these organizations as well as our expert panel. I have to mention it. I think it's my duty to mention it. All the organizations who are participating here are prominent historical organizations with an uncompromised history of fight against imperialism, wars, and at the same time, they are pioneers of struggle for peace. Some of these organizations are old, more than 70 years. Some of them are 60 years. And they have fought very heroic struggles to keep peace in our region and our world. And not only that, all our four panelists are most prominent experienced and principled peace activists and leaders. So on behalf of the passers and the participants, we really value and admire your participation in this webinar. So now I think we can move to the next item of the agenda. So now let's watch a small brief introductory video about AUKUS made by one of our comrades.
Wednesday night saw a relatively unprecedented event. At 10 p.m. UK time, US President Joe Biden, UK Prime Minister Boris Johnson, and Australian PM Scott Morrison held a joint, albeit virtual, press conference to announce a trilateral security pact, one with quite significant ramifications, not just for the three countries involved. Start of a historic security pact between the three nations. Under the pact, known as AUKUS, Australia, UK, and US, the three nations will share technology and expertise in order to ultimately allow Australia to build a fleet of nuclear-powered submarines. The US had previously kept its nuclear submarine technology extremely close to home. Prior to this pact, only the UK had received American nuclear submarine technology, hence their inclusion in this pact. All three leaders were at pains to stress that the submarines will be merely nuclear-powered, but they will not be equipped with nuclear arms. Nuclear-powered submarines have a number of advantages over conventionally powered submarines, most notably when it comes to weapon storage, speed, and endurance. As the Australian government's own press release highlights, nuclear-powered submarines can stay completely submerged for many months, limiting the opportunities for detection by adversaries. France have been set to build 12 conventional submarines for Australia in a deal worth more than 50 billion euro, a deal that has fallen through in light of the pact. It's safe to say that France isn't happy with the move. In line with Australia's obligations under the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the NPT, they will solely be equipped with conventional arms. Five Eyes Intelligence Sharing Alliance, which also includes New Zealand and Canada, an alliance that goes back to the 1940s. China, widely seen as the target of the pact but not officially named as such, was also incredibly quick to criticise AUKUS, arguing that the pact was extremely irresponsible, narrow-minded, severely damages regional peace, intensified the arms race, and is reminiscent of the obsolete Cold War mentality. Not the most glowing of reports.
So it's got everything that I wanted to say in the presentation. So I have to change my talk to something. No, it's already been presented.
Do it as it is. Try to pop it to an angle. Fuck it up. Just do it as it is.
Okay. We will post this short video to Paso's page, and then I think you can refer it again. So now let's move to the next item of the agenda. There will be a short introductory speech about the present situation of Asia and Pacific region by Comrade Sunil Gamage. He's an executive committee member of PASO Sri Lanka. So, Comrade Sunil, you now floor is for you.
Thank you very much, Comrade Bimal. Good evening, dear comrades. First of all, I would like to thank Peace and Solidarity Organization of Sri Lanka, PASOS, giving me this opportunity to address this webinar and express few ideas about the militarizing in the Asia-Pacific region. First of all, why imperialists attempt to keep the power and doing influences over Asia-Pacific region using military agreements? Because powerful countries have long-term plans to secure their supply chains, to ensure the smooth functioning of economies, as well as guarantee the highest rates of return to their capital. For this purpose, all over the world, whole war is being exited between powerful nations with hidden agendas, which have been nicely covered by defense agreements. For this purpose, all powerful countries have established own military bases in the Asia-Pacific region. First of all, let's have a look on the level of militarization in Asia-Pacific region today. What are the United States military bases in Asia-Pacific region? We know they have established 11 base camps in Japan, then 15 base camps in South Korea, and one camp in Singapore, then four camps in Australia, two camps in New Zealand, one camp in Uzbekistan, again one camp in Kyrgyzstan. There are five camps in Philippines and one in Guam. You know, Diogo Garcia is an occupied militarized island. We know Diogo Garcia has a big history about the militarized. So they have established this as an island, militarized island. In addition to the military bases, imperialist and regional powerful countries have had dozens of military agreements with various countries in the Asia-Pacific region. We'll see agreements signed by US with India. In 2002, they have signed General Security of Military Information Agreement. It's called SOMIA. And then 2016, they have signed with India Logistic Support Agreement. It's called LSA. Then there's another agreement in the same year. In 2016, they have signed Logistic Exchange Memorandum of Agreement. It's called LEMOA. Then 2018, Communication Compatibility and Security Agreement. It's called COMCASA. They have signed. COMCASA deals with secure military communication. This also increased the ability to communicate safely with all US-made equipments used by foreign military, such as Japan and Australia. The important fact is disagreement. The data acquired through COMCASA cannot be disclosed or transferred to any person or entity without India consent. Then there's another agreement called BECA. This is called Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement, signed on 26 October 2020. So BECA enables supply of high-end equipment as well as real-time intelligence and information, which will allow India to piggyback on American geospatial information to hit enemies' targets with pinpoint accuracy. So this is a very important point of this BECA agreement. And there's another agreement called Quad, Quadrilateral Security Dialogue. So this was signed by US, and then India, Japan, and Australia are the members of this alliance, and mainly focuses the naval military power within the region. In addition to these agreements, US has signed military agreements called Acquisition and Cross-Servicing Agreements, ACSA, with 38 countries in the Asia-Pacific region. Further, US has signed a strong military agreement with Sri Lanka and with many countries called SOFA. It's called Status of Forces Agreement. Then what are the military agreements signed by India? India has signed a fresh military agreement with Maldives on 22nd February 2021 in the name of harbor protection. Then there's another agreement they have signed, building a full-fledged Army, Navy, and Air Force military base is an island belonging to Mauritius. India has a military bases and facilities in Bhutan, Nepal, Seychelles, Madagascar, Oman, and Tajikistan also. Then we'll see what has China been. Shanghai Cooperation Organization, this is called SCO, also known as Shanghai Pact, is a European, Euro-Asian political, economic, and security alliance established in 2001. We know which represents 40% of the world population and 20% of the world GDP. The organization represents 8 countries, namely China, Russia, Pakistan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, and Kazakhstan, also India. So this is called SCO. There are a few countries involved with this organization as an observer. Even Sri Lanka has involved in this SCO as an observer. On the other side, China has established its foreign military bases in Djibouti, Tajikistan, Myanmar also. Then what are the Australia foreign military bases they have established? Australia has established its own camps in following countries to expand the military power, especially in Asia-Pacific region. Malaysia, they have established a design rifle company, Butterworth, is for the training purposes. Military training purposes, they have established a camp in Butterworth, in Malaysia. Then United Arab Emirates. Then again, they have established an in base camp in Iraq, and then also in Pacific Island, in Solomon Island. So these are the foreign military bases established by Australia. And what are the impacts on the Asia-Pacific region by these military agreements? There are a variety of issues affecting regional, cultural, and political and economic traditions in the region due to these type of military agreements. The one is NATO is developing closer relation with its four Asia-Pacific partners, namely Australia, Japan, Korea, and New Zealand. This is called Pacific NATO, Asia-Pacific NATO, and they are focusing topics of cyber defense, non-proliferation, civil preparedness, women, peace, and security. We know which are common issues even in the many countries. The imperialists and their supportive various military organizations use the local issues to interfere in internal matters of the countries. As an example, North and South Korea issue. Then again, China and Taiwan issue. When we consider the China and Taiwan issue, US used the issue to engage its arm in Taiwan. This US president, the Taiwan president, she's accepted the presence of US arm in Taiwan. So this is the situation, how the US interfere with internal matters in the country. So Defense Secretary of US Mark Esper emphasized the importance of implementing a national defense security plan considering great power competitors and formulated following strategies on priority basis. The one is improve the lethality and readiness of the force. The second one is strengthen allies and build partners. Third one is reform the department for greater efficiency and accountability. Finally, we have to evaluate the impact of this newly established AUKUS within this scenario. Asia and Pacific has been militarizing it at alarming speed, especially after within last two decades. Now this new war machine, AUKUS, born just 50 days ago, is entering into the already highly militarized war zone. What Asia-Pacific region needs is peace and development. Nuclear vessel or military bases neither bring peace nor development. I think our fellow speakers will elaborate the impact of AUKUS on our home region, Asia-Pacific. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Comrade Sunil, for explaining the present military situation in our home region, Asia and Pacific. So now we can move to our main, for the main speakers. So first, without taking any time, I would invite Comrade Iraklis, Executive Secretary of the World Peace Council, to started his speech. Comrade, please.
Thank you, Comrade Bimal, and dear comrades and friends. Our deepest militant peace greetings to all the participants and to all our comrades and friends in Sri Lanka. Allow me first of all to congratulate the Peace and Solidarity Organization of Sri Lanka PASOS for its initiative to organize this online event on the recent military agreement between Australia, the United Kingdom, and the USA, known as AUKUS. PASOS is proving once again that it is following deeply and thoroughly the developments in the region of Asia and the Pacific, always alerted, committed, and vigilant to the threats and dangers posed in front of the peoples regarding peace and security. International developments are complex and dangerous in all parts of the world. Hotspots of confrontation and imperialist wars are manifesting. Competition for control of markets, energy resources and pipelines, maritime freight routes are intensifying. New elements are added to the race of big interests. The intra-imperialist contradictions are being waged through economic and political diplomatic means, are being expressed in military confrontations with the increase in modernization of armaments, while the danger of a wider and even more generalized imperialist war is growing. The United States has withdrawn in 2002 from the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty, the ABM, and in 2017 from UNESCO. In 2018, from the Iran Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the so-called JCPOA. In 2017, they withdrew from the Trans-Pacific Partnership and proceeded to freeze the negotiations on the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Agreement, TTIP, along which was signed with the European Union. In 2019, they withdrew from the agreement on the control of intermediate range nuclear forces, INF. And in 2019, they withdrew from the Paris Agreement on Climate Change, and in 2020, from the Treaty on Open Skies. In addition, they announced that they were considering conducting new nuclear tests in violation of the relevant 1963 international agreement. All the above stays intact, stays as it is by the Biden administration, despite the different rhetoric sometimes. In the Eastern Mediterranean, the Middle East, the Persian Gulf, the Balkans, the Black Sea, the Caucasus, the Central Asia, and the Pacific Ocean, and as well as in the East and South China Sea, Africa and Latin America, till the Arctic Circle, these developments are noted. Part of the conflict map is the Eastern Mediterranean region, which is a channel connecting Asia, Europe, and Africa. Wars, such as in Syria, in Libya, in addition to heavy casualties, have forced millions of people to flee their homes and to move to other countries and to Europe. The 20-year imperialist war the US, NATO, and their allies fought in Afghanistan has a great cost for the Afghan people, and it's fueling new waves of refugees. The provocative handover of the power and heavy, sophisticated weapons to the Taliban by the US shows the hypocrisy and the double moral of the imperialists, who have spent around $2 trillion in 20 years, supposedly in order to combat terrorism. We are extremely concerned about the situation in the Afghan people is facing and going through, and in particular, the female population of the country. The Mujahideen earlier, then Taliban, and other extremist religious forces, which were created, funded, and oriented in the 1970s for more than a decade by the US and its European allies for the purpose of overthrowing the first popular regime in the late 1980s in Afghanistan, took the control in the country for more than 10 years later on. The internationalist support of the USSR, which had brought huge progress in all social fields, was twisted and falsified by many forces and media for ideological reasons. In 2001, after having served the imperialist plans, the Taliban became then the so-called target of their previous masters. The nowadays adjustment of the foreign policy of the US and NATO in Central Asia has in mind the confrontation with Russia and China. Hundreds of thousands of people lost their lives. Millions were displaced and became refugees. Hundreds of billions of US dollars were spent for the military operations of the imperialists and for the establishment and funding of the willing puppet regimes in Kabul. The lucrative opium business mushroomed and multiplied for the last 20 years. The NATO summit last June 2021 came to review, to update, and to expedite a number of decisions from the past. As this war machine, NATO, further increases its aggression by using the new NATO strategy 2030 and the so-called new strategic concept, which is being prepared for the next year. Old and new pretexts, such as hybrid threats, cyber security, and the so-called climate crisis, the energy crisis, and more, are being used to pave the way for new imperialist interventions. At the same time, within NATO, new antagonisms develop between NATO, Germany, between United States and France, between France and Germany, as well as between Turkey and France. So far, these contradictions have been settled by temporary compromises, often in a firefighting manner, but their tangle is becoming increasingly complicated, so that even bourgeois political forces and analysts are questioning the coherence of these imperialist alliances. On the background of all the above, we witnessed recently the signing of the AUKUS agreement, which is an economic, technological, political, and military agreement by which Australia is being supplied with nuclear-powered submarines. This treaty triggers the further escalation of imperialist rivalries as well as new moves on the part of China and Russia. France, which has lost a major submarine deal to Australia worth $50 billion, and the European Union, which has high-level economic ties with China, are reacting to AUKUS and pushing their own plan for a so-called strategic autonomy. It is no secret from the time of the pivot to Asia of the Obama administration that the US was planning to shift 60% of its military power towards Asia and the Pacific Ocean. The Biden administration is carrying on this line, having China as primary target in order to contain the economic and military emerging presence of China. At the same time, the US and its allies have the DPR of Korea as their target, using its powerful Seventh Fleet and the hundreds of military bases in the region for military exercises and provocations. The US has signed with almost all countries of the region bilateral military agreements. They call them so-called mutual defense cooperation agreements, which include the use of military sites and port facilities, and even deployment of troops or establishment of foreign military bases. Such agreement was signed also between the US and the government of Sri Lanka. Allow me here to highlight the firm positions of PASOS against this bilateral agreement and the mobilization of the Sri Lankan people against it. The AUKUS agreement will increase the arms race between all involved parties in a region where also nuclear weapons are deployed. From World Peace Council side, we want to reaffirm once again our position for the total abolition of all nuclear weapons, as we have stated historically with our Stockholm appeal in 1950. But the AUKUS agreement comes also hand in hand with the so-called quadrilateral security dialogue, known as Quad, in which the US, Japan, Australia, and India take part. Apparently, the aim is to create an alliance in order to pursue the imperialist plans in the East and South China Seas in order to counter the presence of China in the region. The US tries to line up Asian countries with its strategy, using China's claims in the region as ground and pretext. Here, it is interesting to observe that India, which is participating with China in the BRICS, in the BRICS alliance, and other regional structures, such as Shanghai Cooperation and others, is playing a key role in other alliances like the Quad, which is openly targeting China. The above-mentioned developments are of great concern, and the peace-loving forces and member organizations of the World Peace Council in the region are being called to reveal the imperialist plans, to reject them, and to mobilize awareness and actions of the peoples against them. For the World Peace Council, it is important to underline that the differences and disputes in the region have to be resolved by political and peaceful means, based on the international law and on the 1982 UN Convention of the Law of the Seas, UNCLOS. No unilateral military actions or hegemonic behavior can be accepted from any side. Neither do we believe that forces such as the USA, who are offering their so-called good services to Asian countries, are concerned about the peoples and their needs and rights. There was and there is no place on earth where the United States of America, speaking about its government, has intervened for the sake of the sovereign rights of countries and nations historically. But allow me here to refer also to the important allies of the US, which is the imperialist European Union, which is steadily militarizing itself and getting involved in many parts of the world, including the Asia and Pacific. The European Union seeks to expand its action internationally and militarily on the basis of the global strategy that adapts to the needs of European monopolies. Thus, the so-called Permanent Structured Cooperation, PESCO, was established. At the same time, the French-inspired European Intervention Initiative, composed by 9 countries, is being promoted in order to overcome the delays caused by the unanimous decision-making process in the European Union, which is not always given, so that the imperialist missions can be carried out without delays. Already today, the European Union has deployed imperialist missions on three continents. The EU has dozens of battle groups as rapid intervention forces composed by four or five countries each time, supposedly in order to safeguard and protect peace and stability in the world. The European Union is functioning in military terms as complementary force to NATO, and it is not by chance that 90% of the NATO members are also European Union members. There cannot be any illusion about the nature and or role of the European Union, which is protecting and promoting the privileges and the profits of the European monopolies, often in competition to the ones of the United States. But when it comes to the rights of the peoples in various parts of the world, they are standing all together, hand in hand. The developments are of concern, and as World Peace Council, we are on alert. Despite the difficulties and restrictions due to the ongoing health pandemic, the World Peace Council will undertake initiatives and actions in order to rally forces and movements together against the imperialist threats and plans for a world free from imperialist wars and exploitation. We wish you, dear friends and comrades, all good health and strength in our common struggle. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade Executive Secretary, World Peace Council, for providing a very sharp analysis with a lot of information, which normally rare to find in the capitalist and general press. So thank you, Comrade, for your analysis. And now we are moving to our next panelist, Comrade Romina Beitseen, Secretary, CICD Australia. Comrade, now the floor is for you.
Thank you, Comrade Bimal, and thank you for Peace and Solidarity Organization Sri Lanka for inviting me to speak tonight. The introductory was quite good, so it may be a bit repetition of what we heard in the slides. So the recent announcement of trilateral security a partnership between Australia, the United States and the UK, known as AUKUS, has implications for regional security in the Indo-Pacific. The three allies said they would spend the next 18 months sorting out the details of a security collaboration that President Biden was so celebrative and called it as historic. Now, over a month into the timetable, the partners are quite quietly coming to grip with the proposals' enormous complications. Australia has chosen to forgo any constructive relationship with China and to escalate tensions by engaging with the military control of the USA. This choice will create regional political and economic instability. It also reveals a complete failure of strategic thinking about communicating China's world view in peaceful and non-militarized world. According to the creators of this agreement, it is a pact to counter China's influence in the Indo-Pacific region. Australia will enter into an undefined arrangement with the with the USA and the United Kingdom for regional security, they call it. The pact binds Australia conclusively to the United States and Great Britain for generations. Many Indo-Pacific nations have only recently emerged from a long period of oppressive European imperialism. Surely tensions will increase, as already suggested by the Indonesian and Malaysian responses to AUKUS. Sending war-fighting subs to potential conflict in the Indo-Pacific region is yet another breach of international law by the three Anglo allies. It is time to stand up and oppose the reckless and immoral move by these countries. China is correct when it said that AUKUS betrays a Cold War mentality in international relations. This agreement has set Australia on a path to potentially obtain nuclear-powered submarines, which in total could cost Australia between $120 to $180 billion. The United States and now Australia states that the China problem has to be confronted militarily and isolated. Such a policy is not a strategy for peace. Australia's Prime Minister Scott Morrison has laid out an ambitious view, vision, saying that at least 8 nuclear propelled submarines using American or British technology will be built and enter the waters starting in the late 2030s. That is in 20 years' time. Australian Strategic Policy Institute, ASPI, a think tank directly influenced, funded by a corporate weapons incorporation, claims that AUKUS represents the most important pivot point in Australia's strategic policy since the Second World War. They argue that Australia now understands it must make the uncomfortable choice it has avoided for so long and choose between China, its largest trading partner, or the United States, with which it has an alliance. AUKUS, therefore, has firmly placed Australia's choice on the side of the United States, which that is a good reason for peace movement to be very worried about. International opposition to AUKUS, peace and common security advocates from around the world oppose Quad, Japan, India, US, Australia, and AUKUS, Australia, UK, US militarism, and urge common security collaborations to address experimental nuclear, climate, and pandemic threats. Meetings on the eve of the Quad Alliance Summit, peace, justice, and common security advocates from the Quad and AUKUS member countries and Australia, Philippines, Vietnam, Japan, South Korea, India, Britain, Germany, and the US met to analyze and build opposition to the dangerous and increased militarism of the Quad and AUKUS alliances. Opposing the AUKUS, Australian peace organizations are demanding that Australia not become a base for the US, military, that Australian sovereignty not to be surrendered to the US. The transfer of highly enriched uranium and related technologies to Australia violates the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and encourages nuclear weapons proliferation. It provides Australia with resources needed to become a nuclear power and significant political and military figures in India, South Korea, and Japan ask why they haven't been why they have been denied these capabilities by the United States. The AUKUS alliance increases pressure on ASEAN and other regional nations to choose sides in a way that compromises their independence. Australia's island neighbours will not welcome further nuclearization of the region, even as they face current security challenges, including the climate emergency and the COVID-19 pandemic. AUKUS could open the door for other nuclear-armed countries to make similar offers. The China-Pakistan nuclear collaboration could take such a turn. This deal makes no strategic sense for Australia. The timescale reinforces the entire air of unreality about equipment, equipping these submarines, only a couple of which may be operationally available at any one time. Some commentators suggest Australia must buy some submarines to help US to counter the Chinese threat to Taiwan. But no one knows that this will happen. This will happen to China or the US in the radically uncertain future. By 2060, China may be the dominant country in the Asia. No credible threat has been presented to justify this agreement, and no specific case has been presented to justify the need for nuclear submarines. As has already been seen, the US could be ruled by a madman eager to use nuclear weapons. However, whether the US is led by a Biden or Trump, it has shown it is willing to go to war or use nuclear weapons to support its political and strategic control. That's what they're interested in control. The chances that Australia having nuclear submarines means that it would involve itself in a war over Taiwan in 2060, which is a remote possibility. It does not constitute a rational basis for deciding now to commit more than $100 billion to these weapons and missiles platform. The US has 68 nuclear submarines. The prospect of Australia getting 8 by 2060 is not a game changer for serious American strategies. Australia does not have the technical infrastructure or skilled sailors to operate or maintain these subs. The cost to establish these capacities is extremely expensive and still will only provide a weapon under the control of the US. By far, the most important change occurred when Australia agreed to host several joint facilities that produce real-time intelligence fed directly into the US warfighting machine from Pine Gap outside Alice Springs, Shoal Bay near Darwin, and Geraldton and Northwest Cape in Western Australia. So they are the strategic importance for the United States, and they've been using them for years. Among other capabilities, these facilities intercept a huge range of electronic signals from China, as well as detecting data on heat emissions from missiles, jet engines, and ground explosions. So will China and Russia believe Biden when he pledges that the administration will pursue diplomacy rather than exercise military force to solve global crisis? In practical terms, what happens what happened was Australia's political elite acted like a client state and simply rubber stamped UK foreign policy. No hard questions were asked, and Australia distorted into the slaughterhouse of World War I. In 1941, Australia turned to the US. History has now repeated itself. Since World War II, Australia has followed US to every war ever since been involved with the US. As the US has entered a period of economic and military decline, China continues to rise. It is now a crucial for Australia, a trade partner. Now we have AUKUS and the plan to encircle the Chinese in the South and East China Seas. The US-led Quad Alliance, which include India, Japan, and Australia, is another strategy to encircle China. Opposing the AUKUS alliance, Australian peace organizations are demanding that Australia reject the nuclear submarines and the US military buildup on Australian soil. A number of meetings amongst peace movement nationally and internationally have taken place so far. There is a monthly Zoom meeting and of all interested groups exchanging ideas of putting together some campaigns to oppose AUKUS. On 31st of October, a protest took place in Perth. A UK astute class nuclear submarine was visiting Perth, the first visit of its kind since the AUKUS announcement, a show of what's to come. Peace activists very quickly went down and called for an end to AUKUS, demanding that the government signs and ratifies the nuclear ban treaty and confirm there will be no nuclear power in Australia. National AUKUS coalition movement has been set up, and there will be a meeting of this coalition on the 7th of November, this coming Sunday. This is the initial meeting to determine support for the formation of national coalition movement and to discuss proposals for nationwide activities on the weekend of 10th and to 12th of December. So there will be a national campaign on those 2 days. So the same as a other peace organization, we say no to military coalition, no to Quad, no to AUKUS, no to war, yes to peace. Thank you, comrades.
Thank you, Comrade Romina. You explained about your plans and your protests and your struggles to defeat and to explain the evil nature of these military attacks. And we wish all the success, and we would ask our Sri Lankan community and other communities who are living in Australia to join with your cause for peace. Thank you, Prem. Now, then let's move to Comrade Harchand Singh, Deputy General Secretary of All India Peace and Solidarity Organization, Officer. Dear Comrade Harchand, now floor is open for you.
Thank you, Bimal. Thank you for being so nice and organizing this meeting. I would contribute basically on AUKUS, its concept and implications on Asia-Pacific and world order. It is natural that since there was no specific marked subjects divided between the speakers, so there is a possibility that there should be some repetition, but due to the time factor, it may be ignored. First of all, I would like to greet all the friends on behalf of All India Peace and Solidarity Organization who are participating in this important webinar. I would also like to sincerely thank the host organization, PSO of Sri Lanka, for organizing this webinar on this very important subject, which is concerning to all, especially to the countries and people of the Asia-Pacific region. Australia, UK, and the US has created this group called AUKUS to show its hegemony in the Asia-Pacific. Before debating the concept of AUKUS, it would be very important to discuss the background of launching AUKUS. This has come in the background when the Americans and its allies have to leave Afghanistan in a severe embarrassment. This has a huge criticism from all the world to the intervention of the American imperialism and its allies in the internal affairs of the countries. It would also be interesting to note that there were three major developments in the region. First, the Chinese have first time tested its hypersonic missile, which was a shock to the Americans and its allies. Secondly, India has tested intermediary missiles, which have a range of 5,000 kilometers. Thirdly, this AUKUS, this agreement have been signed by America, United States, and Australia. There are serious contradictions with regard to the said agreement within the European allies, especially by the French. As stated above, this agreement came as US troops made an ignominious retreat from Afghanistan. Many therefore see it as such needed assertion by the US to reassure its allies and dissuade competitors by raising a new flag in the theater of Indo-Pacific. This is an attempt by the United States imperialism to show the world that it has still a capacity to act as a super cop. In fact, AUKUS, in a sense, has created more problems for the transatlantic relationship between the US and Europe than it has for the Quad. The nuclear submarine deal definitely challenges core security trade interests of France, which the US has stolen a march over them. As far as India is concerned, it indeed, as an Indian Ocean power, wants to have nuclear submarine technologies. The US has been reluctant about sharing high technology with India. With the US committed to technology sharing with its new partners, if India's alternative expands, then the fact of choice of always good and French could be a cordial to that offer. Australia and had signed a $90 billion submarine contract with France to procure the nuclear submarine. So it has an enormous impact on the French economy. This is main reason that the French is alleging that it has been kept in dark and the deal has been signed on its back. These developments imply heightened threats to India, Russia, the Central Asian region, and even China. AUKUS has sparked fire criticism and widespread concerns over its impact on the regional security in the Asia-Pacific region and on global non-proliferation. Changes of power balance in the region is a worry for India, and the US is now promoting a security partnership with its English allies, which India is not part of it. It might possibly upset the balance of power in the region and set off new tensions to India's east. This right-wing Indian government, who always claimed to be a partner with the United States and its allies, have also got shocked that it has not been taken into confidence while floating this new alliance. The major concern is that there is no official statement issued by the Southeastern Asian's multilateral body, the the Association of South Asian Nations, even though the agreement may have significant political impact on the region. No doubt that the silence is also fueled by the split among Asian member countries with different views of China's presence in the region. Some support the agreement and some are against it. The relationship between each country and China seems to have influenced these different stances. Maybe as of now, it looks that the said alliance is basically against rising power of China, but that is not the case. In fact, the alliance is to facilitate the politics of domination in the region. The alliance is well planned to counter all those voices which are or would be raised in future against the politics of domination and capturing the waters, and it is the waters, and it has no doubt huge natural resources lying beneath these waters. This is a high time for the peoples of the countries of Asia Pacific, government and all progressive forces to get united and oppose this move by the said alliance led by US imperialism to put their footsteps in the region through military alliance. This is a direct intervention in the region and is a huge threat to the peace and security in the region. These countries in the region should rise up from their minor differences and come together to fight the bigger enemy coming from outside. The small differences, including the maritime line, boundaries, and others, could be resolved through negotiations based upon international law and conventions, mutually, amicably, and with neighborhood understanding. Finally, I would like to thank all of you for your kind attention and sparing your valuable time and for participating in this webinar, important webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Comrade Harchand Singh. AUKUS stance is a very progressive and very encouraging one to people who are living in especially Southeast Asian countries, because India is a huge and a very powerful nation in this region. So its voice matters. So when we heard the peace-loving voice from India, I think it matters most to us. So now, actually, comrades, we are moving smoothly as we planned. All of our experts are keeping according to the given times. So now we are moving to Comrade Ajamu Baraka. He's a Secretariat member of the U.S. Peace Council, and he's the national organizer of the Black Alliance for Peace. And comrade, you are fighting with the enemy face to face while living inside his belly. So always, U.S. Peace Movement gives us a great moral support and even encouragement. So now, floor is for you, comrade.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Comrade Bamo. And thank you to the Sri Lanka Peace and Solidarity Organization for allowing me to take part, and the U.S. Peace Council to take part in this very important discussion to address the challenges and achievements of a region that represents almost half of the world's population. A region that has shown the world how to struggle as its peoples have engaged in historic struggles for national liberation and social transformation. Dear comrades, we are facing a momentous moment in history where the decisions that are made at this conjuncture will determine the course between barbarism or emancipation. In order to guide our decisions, we must ensure that we avoid subjectivist errors, grounding our analysis in our best understanding of the material world and the social and class forces dialectically linked in the contradictory social struggles. In my brief comments, I will provide an understanding of how we in the U.S. see the context of U.S. policies and that inform the AUKUS agreement, and what must be done by anti-imperialist and anti-war forces to undermine the imperialist designs and danger represented by U.S. and European policies in the Asian Pacific region in order to achieve for ourselves peace, security, and transformation for collective humanity. So let me begin. First, it's important to understand that the U.S. commitment to global hegemony is a bipartisan position, strategically informed by the doctrine of full spectrum dominance. The AUKUS agreement is just one aspect of a dramatic and dangerous shift in U.S. global geostrategic policies. And I think our previous speakers have touched on these points very clearly. Full spectrum dominance, the targeting of real or imagined regional rivals, was and is the strategic rationale for the so-called pivot to Asia, first under Obama, that had both a military and political economic component. Under Trump, it was articulated as a commitment to a free and open Indo-Pacific and an attempt to recalibrate U.S. China economic relations. This was the basis for the infamous trade war between the U.S. And China. Both initiatives saw a threat in China's growing wealth, political influence, military power, and both eventually came to be associated almost entirely with Pentagon pronouncements and efforts to preserve U.S. hegemony through military superiority. And these positions represented a ruling class commitment to a militarized response to the growing independence of China. Many people call this position the military first position. This position is reflected in U.S. policies that are very clear. Trump's 2018 national security strategy reflected a consensus among the foreign policy community that shifted policy from the anti-terrorism focus to what they call great power rivalry, with China and Russia as the main targets. The national security strategies describe a China that seeks Indo-Pacific regional hegemony in the near term and global preeminence in the future. And it predicted and prioritized long-term competition. This position, of course, did not receive any real pushback because it was something that represented a new position among not only the foreign policy community, but the ruling class elite. It's instructive to remember that people criticized Trump for abrogating the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action with Iran. But as Comrade Iraklis reminded us, there was not much pushback when the U.S. withdrew from the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, an even more dangerous move. You see, because free from the prohibition from the development and deployment of intermediate range missiles and weapons, the U.S. engaged in a rapid, open development of a new series of cruise and hypersonic weapons with the intention of deployment in their Indo-Pacific command structure. Additionally, the U.S. has encouraged Japan to develop hypersonic weapons and remove all restrictions imposed on their puppet regime in South Korea on the weight and range of its ballistic missiles. It reconciled with the Philippines, pushed through a $2.6 billion new arms sale agreement with the Philippines, net being concerned about the critique and criticism of the human rights stance of the Filipino president. It has established new bases in the Federated States of Micronesia, an expanded presence in Guam, a new base in Papua New Guinea to be shared with Australia, and new radar systems in throughout the region. This is the context for the agreement between the Anglo-colonial and white supremacist settler colonial states represented in AUKUS. Along with the agreement to transfer cruise missiles to Australia, the US cut the rug from under France with this agreement to acquire US-produced nuclear-powered submarines as part of a three-way defense technology pact. This new trilateral agreement was greeted by most Washington observers as a major step forward in China and China policy, even as it has led to new tensions with its NATO ally, France. And with Brazil's, with Biden's withdrawal from Afghanistan, additional weapons, equipment, and troops have been freed up to support the military first strategy of confrontation with China. What has been the result? By shifting military personnel and hardware into the region and encouraging its allies to enlarge their military arsenals, tensions in the region are at an all-time high, with the possibility of conflict on the horizon. During the Cold War period, there was what was referred to as strategic stability. With the rough military parity between the US and Soviet Union and the logic of mutually assured destruction was accepted, the pursuit of strategic stability provided a framework for managing the existential risks associated with massive nuclear arsenals. A first strike was seen as unlikely because it was understood that a retaliatory strike would occur. But comrades, there is no strategic stability when hypersonic weapons can be deployed within hundreds of miles of an adversary that can give it a first strike capability. So what about domestic opposition to these clear, provocative military moves on the part of US authorities? Is there a difference between these approaches and the Biden administration? We say no. In fact, Biden is seen as even more aggressive than Donald Trump. Are the social forces associated with the Democratic Party likely to oppose aggressive policies in the region or even the world? No. For example, Biden has pursued a strictly military approach to North Korea. His administration has encouraged South Korea to field its own submarine-launched ballistic missiles. Democrats supported the Obama pivot and opposed Trump's attempt at de-escalating tensions on the Korean Peninsula, even to the extent of passing legislation preventing him from removing troops from South Korea. This has created a situation where anti-war sentiment that in the past would have resided with liberals are now being completely dissipated, with the Democrat Party aligned organizations muting their critique and criticism of the administration in order to retain a seat at the table for responsible discussions on US foreign policies. US labor unions are in lockstep with Democratic administrations, and progressive and self-identified radical groups have embraced US centrism and have little to say about US foreign policy, except to support interventions as a result of them embracing the assumptions underlining the 21st century version of the white man's burden in the form of humanitarian intervention and the responsibility to protect. So what is to be done? Comrades, there are clear signs of the strength of popular resistance in many regions of the world, confronting the existential threats that imperialism continues to pose for collective humanity. For anti-imperialist forces, there is an urgent need to develop and broaden our fronts of struggle against imperialism. That has to take place in the following ways. First, the ideological war of position. War must be seen and framed as a class and colonial issue. It must delegitimize the justifications for US and European imperialist wars. We must confront and identify the EU, NATO, axis of domination. Expose and reject the ideological mystification of liberal values and the West as defenders of human rights. Identify the US as the number one violator of human rights. Increase the critique of US domestic economic and political contradictions. Raise the issue of international law. US and European attempts to undermine international law must be identified and critiqued. For those of us in the US, the ruling class policies have exposed the hidden nature of the capitalist dictatorship. We will make it more difficult for the ruling class to get away with the policies that were unopposed just in the recent past. Friends, we must build movements for regional zones of peace. We must close down all US and NATO bases. We must reconnect the anti-nuclear and anti-war and anti-imperialist movements. We must strengthen the structural ties between anti-war and anti-imperialist movements and the global movement against climate change. And we must decolonize human rights and reframe them as people-centered human rights. Friends, let us commit to an intensification of the struggles against empire, against colonialism, neocolonialism, white supremacy, all forms of regional and foreign interventions. We must oppose sanctions, all forms of oppression, and the structural violence of capitalism. Let us denounce the number one violator of human rights and threat to the peace, the United States of America, and redouble our efforts to build a world free from war, exploitation, degradation, and despair. All peoples and nations have a right to self-determination, to decide their own political systems, and to live in peace. We say, all power to the people, defeat imperialism, long live the ideals of revolutionary transformation. Thank you.
Thank you, comrade. All power to the people. Comrades, I think that all four main panelists expressed their valuable views as well as they analyzed their situation very well. And now actually we are moving to your session, that is the questions, comments, and answers session. So before we start the Q&A session, I have to make a few housekeeping announcements regarding the Q&A session. First, I would like to ask a request from all the participants. When you are asking questions, try to be brief as possible by not exceeding 2 to 3 minutes. Second, please focus the questions and comments to the subject of the webinar. Third, if any of our participants wants to ask questions in Sinhala language, our Sri Lankan language, Sinhala, please type it and send it to the chat box. We will translate it and send it to the panelists. So now I think that everyone can use this platform. But before that, I would ask to make a brief comment from the Philippine Peace Council, Comrade Robert. Because Philippines also part of this Asia Pacific family, and I think our host and organizers will unmute his mic and give the floor to Comrade Robert. Robert, you can start the session.
Good evening, comrades and friends. I would like only to read a statement from the Philippine Peace Solidarity Council. Dear comrade, the Philippine Peace and Solidarity Council sends warmest greetings to all the participants of today's webinar on AUKUS, Militarizing Asia Pacific, and commends you and the Peace and Solidarity Organization of Sri Lanka, PASOS, for initiating and hosting this very important webinar. Indeed, the very recent rise of the Australia-UK-US military alliance is an additional militarization and threat to peace in the Asia-Pacific region and underpins the growing US NATO's versus China military confrontation in our region, and particularly in the South China Sea. This confrontation is of great concern to the World Peace Council and its national affiliates in our region, which are struggling for a peaceful and just world free from nuclear and other weapons of mass destruction, and free from foreign military bases and forces. The Philippine Peace Solidarity Council position has consistently been that of opposition to US and other imperialist military presence in our country and in our region, and opposition to imperialist moves to military encircle and threaten the People's Republic of China, the Democratic People's Republic of Korea, the Russian Federation, and any other country which dares to take an independent path of development free from US and other imperialist dictates. For this same reason, the PPSC strongly condemns the US blockade of Socialist Cuba and the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. Last July, the PPSC raised its voice along with the World Peace Council and its national affiliates throughout the world against US imperialism, attempt to sow discord and mayhem in Cuba. Today, we again condemn the renewed US imperialist plans to artificially create destabilization inside Cuba this November. Further, the PPSC also condemns the US proxy war against Syria and the US sanction against Nicaragua, Bolivia, and Iran. The PPSC upholds solidarity with the struggle of the Palestinian people against Zionist occupation, as well as with the struggle of the Sahrawi Arab Democratic Republic against Moroccan occupation. Regarding the ASEAN region, the PPSC supports the struggle of the people of Myanmar for an end to military rule resulting from the February 1 coup d'etat this year, and for a return to civilian rule led by the National League of Democracy, which won the election before the coup. At present, the main burning concerns of the PPSC, which directly affect our country, are the following. The further militarization of South China Sea with a stronger NATO presence with the coming of British and German warships to join US-led fleet patrols, which will ratchet up tensions with China. Second, the additional round of the regional arms race with the recent rise of the Australia-UK-US AUKUS military alliance posing an additional threat to peace in our region. Australia's acquisition of nuclear-powered submarines from the USA and UK technology is a violation of the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, to which the USA and UK are both as signatories. More weapons of this type can only lead to more confrontation and instability, while eating up great resources that should better be used in confronting the pandemic. Submarines are stealthy attack vessels that secretly close in on the maritime areas of a target country for the surprise and shorter delivery of offensive weapons of mass destruction. This is underscored in the incident last October 2, when the USS Connecticut, a Seawall class fast attack nuclear submarine of the US 7th Fleet, hit an undersea object and was forced to surface close to the Paracel Island, some 150 nautical miles from the Yulin submarine base in China, southern island province of Hainan. Third, China's building up military bases on artificial islands, which are within the exclusive economic zones of the Philippines, Vietnam, and Malaysia, as well as China's insistence of an air and naval defense identification zone, requiring passing aircraft and ships to identify themselves in a very wide area, which does not even belong to China. The PPSC condemns the China claim to a 9-line area, which encompasses almost 90% of the whole South China Sea, and which violate the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, UNCLOS. These 9-lines includes large portion of the exclusive economic zones and extended continental shelves of the Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, Brunei, and even Indonesia. In an affront to the whole world, China also includes in this 9-line area the high seas, which legally belong to the whole of humanity, to all nations, including landlocked ones. Significantly, China's 9-line map was presented to the UN only in May 2009, or 27 years after the forging of the 1982 UNCLOS, to which China is also a signatory. China's 9-line claim was already declared invalid by the ad hoc UNCLOS arbitral tribunal in The Hague in its July 12, 2016 arbitral award decision. By legally building and maintaining military bases within the maritime domains of neighboring countries, China has started to foist an era of humiliation on her neighbors. Fourth, China's claim that she has the right to reunify Taiwan, Formosa under her, even through a bloody invasion, considering that Philippines is the country closest to Taiwan, and you anywhere foisted upon the island will surely have a genocidal repercussion on our country. The PPSC opposes all military maneuvers and war games conducted by all forces in the vicinity of the Taiwan Strait, as any incident of miscalculation could immediately escalate into a major war in our region. We call on China to stop all military threats against Taiwan and end any claim to the right to invade Taiwan. We have consistently supported the call of DPRK for the peaceful and independent reunification of the Korean Peninsula. And we can only similarly support a call for the peaceful and independent reunification of Taiwan under China through peaceful and independent negotiation. In this situation, the strengthening of our struggle for the immediate withdrawal of all imperialist forces from our region is complemented by our struggle against China's hegemonism. Our slogan for a nuclear weapon free and foreign forces free from South China Sea and Southeast Asia is a balanced demand against both imperialism and hegemonism. We hope that in the adoption of an action program as a result of this past hosted webinar on AUKUS, militarizing Asia Pacific, due attention could be given to the tense situation in the South China Sea, stemming from aggressive action by both U.S. state imperialism and China hegemonism. Finally, in the face of the present pandemic, we wish all members, supporters, and friends of PASOS in the World Peace Council the best health and every success in our common endeavors for the defense of peace, and in the struggle of disarmament, freedom, working class power, and the socioeconomic progress. Thank you.
Okay, Kamal. Thank you very much. Now I think all our participants can post their questions. You can ask questions from the main four panelists. And you can, if you want, you can name any panelist also, and try to be brief and try to be focused on this AUKUS military pact, because I know that here we have a number of activists and journalists and artists and political party members. So this is a through this webinar, we are getting a lot of information and many reasons to fight against this further militarization of our home area. So I think that now you have the floor. So I think host and organizers can allow our participants to make their questions. Please unmute their mic.
Hello, can you guys hear me? Hello?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. And my name is Hifaz. I'm from Sri Lanka. And thank you, Pastors, for this opportunity. And I would like to extend my gratitude for the respective panel as well for the valuable explanation. Well, when I hear for the explanation of the respective panel, it's clear that we have to expect the unexpected in order to spoil the regional peace and especially to create an uncertain situation in the region. My main concern is what's the assurance and who will take the responsibility to ensure the regional peace to fight against the so-called major countries? And also, what would be the role of Human Rights Council in order to keep the regional peace? And yeah, that's my question. Thank you.
Yes, can you hear me, comrades?
Yeah.
I think that, comrade, please, let's allow one of our panelists to speak, comment or answer on the first question, then we can move to the next question. Please, can someone answer on the problem?
Vimal, may I suggest let more people speak? Otherwise, if we do for each question or comment respond, If we do for each question such a round, then not many participants will speak. So
yes. Okay. I do agree with you. So then let's do like that. We will get three, four questions, and then you can answer. I think it's better.
Yes, I'd like to ask something.
Please.
Can I speak? Can I ask a question?
Yes, please ask your question.
Yes, I am Bornali Mukherjee from India. My concern is this, that we are finding that this subcontinent is in the guard of war economy. And we are finding that there are two specific lobbies siding this war economy. We have heard that Iran has already transferred its nuclear know-how and weapons to Taliban. And we already know that UK, US are the other side of the anti-peace lobby. So my concern is that shouldn't the peace-loving people of this subcontinent stay away from both the lobbies, that is the US-UK lobby in one side and the other side is the Taliban-Chinese lobby, and try to say no to the war economy and try to say no to both these lobbies? I find from the four speakers, honorable speakers, that they are siding the Chinese lobby. So my question is that, is my concern true?
I think our panelists will answer when they are answering the all questions. So I think we can give the floor to another participant.
Hello. Hello, can you hear me?
Sure, yes.
Okay, I'm Hiraz from Japan. I would like to ask a question about the situation in Japan, because Japan is a country that severely suffered from Second World War, but American camps are still established in Japan. Then current situation, also Japan has linked with the court organization. Isn't it risky to talk about peace in such a situation? This is my question. Thank you.
I think let's get another question.
Okay, I have one question. My name is Buddhika from Sri Lanka. Basically, my question is related to one specific aspect of this matter. We all know that as a result of this, you know, tri-party agreement, we know France has lost a significant commercial deal as a consequence. And we saw the diplomatic anger and the disappointment presented by them. And consequently, we saw US president had to apologize in a way. We don't know underneath what's going on, basically. But my question is, will there be any long-term outcome of this, leaving the France out of this equation? And can we expect some sort of favorable, unsettlement from their alignment? Or will that be a temporary turmoil which will be settled within their home? This is my question, basically. Thank you.
Okay. Now, I think that we got four questions, and I think now the panelists are free to answer. I think you can choose among within you when you are commenting. So, choice for the panelists.
Comrade, I can jump in real quick and with brief comments on the questions. First, let me say that I think one thing we have to come to terms with is that for those of us who are committed to peace and social justice, people-centered human rights, that we recognize that the only way we're going to be able to realize those things is as a consequence of popular resistance, of popular struggles. Of course, we can appeal to and utilize various UN structures, including its Human Rights Council. But we recognize that that kind of state-centered and legalistic approach to addressing human rights issues has not been that effective. It can be valuable in terms of the broader ideological struggle, but in terms of it impacting in real terms the realities on the ground, that comes out of the thrust of the masses themselves. On the issue of Iran and the notion that the Iranians have transferred nuclear technology and to the Taliban, I mean, that is, I guess we have to comment on that. But basically, it is an absurdity, that and a smear. If there was evidence, we would it'd be more clear. But its inherent strategic illogic is something that should be, I think, wholeheartedly dismissed. And for the U.S. Peace Council, we take no sides except the side of the people. We are not grounded in any so-called camp. We do adhere to the principles and values of national sovereignty and self-determination. We believe in the possibility of people-centered human rights, and we attempt to call it as we see it in terms of these various issues. And the way we see it is that the number one violator of human rights on the planet is in fact the US along with its European allies. So while there may be contradictions, and they are with other forces, we see the primary antagonistic contradiction being between the Pan-African, Pan-European project and the rest of collective humanity. And in terms of Japan, we hope that the peace movement in Japan is strong enough to resist the efforts on the part of the U.S. to encourage them to engage more militaristic activities. We call for self-determination of the people of Okinawa, and we say close all U.S. bases. in Japan and really throughout the region. Over.
Thank you, Comrade Ajamu. Yes, Iraklis.
Go ahead.
May I say a few words?
Sure.
Allow me, first of all, speaking on behalf of the World Peace Council, to define and underline that despite the violation of international law and of all the framework which was created in the United Nations for decades long, with the overthrow of correlation of forces after 1991, some people may say, okay, what is international law today? The World Peace Council supports and stresses the need to respect the founding principles of the UN Charter with full knowledge, we are not naive, that the UN is today being often abused and actually reflecting, as it was always reflecting, the correlation of forces in each moment. So in an absolute negative correlation of forces balance in the world, the UN is suffering also from that. And often we see double standards, double moral, and non-compliance with the resolutions the UN has taken many times and for many years. And such examples there are many. If you take just the case of Palestine for more than 70 years, you will understand what we mean. I started with that because it is important to identify the enemies of peace wherever and whenever they act in whatever corner of the world. And that's why the World Peace Council is identifying itself as an anti-imperialist organization. So we are not anti-American or anti-British, anti-French, or and we are not anti-Chinese. We take positions based on our understanding that we are on the side of the poor and the oppressed, on the side of the people struggling for their right to determine and to decide upon their future freely and without foreign interference and any sanctions threats against their sovereignty. And we are taking positions on that. Does it mean that we are pro-Chinese, as the questions raised? Even in a way, I wouldn't say that it is fair to the facts to say Chinese lobby or anti-Chinese lobby. We are neither nor. We don't endorse all elements of the foreign policy of China. In points and in issues where China is being targeted and is being victimized by the US, by the European Union, by NATO, we support the just positions of the Chinese people and its government when it comes to provocations around the Tibet issue or the Muslim minority of the Uyghurs in Western China, or the provocations upon religious pretexts with some religious sects. But we have stated clearly when China, with its veto power in the United Nations Security Council, did not exercise its veto power in order to block, in order to veto the 1973 resolution of the UN Security Council about Libya, China both and Russia together voted abstention while they could have vetoed one of the two or both that resolution. Would the bombing and the massacre in Libya would have stopped? Most probably not, because the French Mirage fighters were already in the air and were ready to bomb Libya anyway. But they made themselves co-guilty because accomplices in political terms, and actually all the developments in Libya affected the whole Middle East, as we all know. This means that wherever China or Russia or any other force takes wrong positions, which are against the principles, the founding principles of the UN, we have the duty, and we have also the courage to tell so. And in particular about Asia and the Pacific and the South China Sea, the positions of the World Peace Council are crystal clear. The disputes have to be resolved bilaterally and finally multilaterally amongst all the involved parties in peaceful and diplomatic terms. We don't accept and recognize unilateral steps, whether by taking island territory and then negotiate on the basis of the change of the facts on the ground, nor do we accept threats amongst the neighbors from one to another. This is not an atmosphere of negotiation. But we have clearly pointed out that such negotiations and multilateral agreements cannot be done by the. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, but you have to switch on your video.
Yes,
we can't see.
The problem is that my battery went. Can you hear me at least?
Yes.
Okay. So I was saying that the South China Sea cannot be the problems and the territorial disputes cannot be solved with the willing allies, willing good services of the United States, which is not part of the South China Sea. The pretext of a free maritime, circulation and traffic cannot be used by anybody in order to interfere in the affairs of the 5, 6, 7 countries of the South China Sea, which have to solve their differences based on UNCLOS and the United Nations, 1982, the United Nations Convention of Law of the Seas. And last, the thing about Japan. Japan, actually, and here we have to, again, differentiate. We are not talking about the Japanese people. We are talking about the Japanese government. Despite the fact that it is the first and only victim of nuclear bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, it is not willing to sign the non-proliferation treaties. It is not willing to fulfill the wishes and the desire of the Japanese people, which are by vast majority against the nuclear weapons and such threats. And it is actually cynical that Japan is talking, the Japanese governments are talking about peace when they have actually already violated, and they are violating their Article 9 of their constitution, because already from the times of the Iraq war, they had troops, Air Force, supposedly as a humanitarian help. I can't understand how Air Force, the Japanese Air Force, can be humanitarian help. In Iraq, they were there. So they have violated it actually already. And the reason why Japan has not nuclear weapons itself is a historical reason, because of the defeat of the Japanese Empire in the Second World War. Otherwise, it is one of the best allies of the U.S., and they are, together with South Korea, exercising militarily around the Korean Peninsula and so on. So our solidarity goes with the Japanese people and the Japanese anti-war movement against the 110, I think, military bases of the U.S. and Japan, and of course against the establishment of new bases like the Okinawa. Thank you.
Okay, I think we can get a few more questions from the participants, and then I think we can start from other two panelists. Then we can ask other two panelists also to answer if they want. So now floor is open for the participants. You can post your questions and comments.
Good evening, Bimal. Can I ask a question? I'm Kumudu sure. Fonseca.
Yes, thank you.
Now, this wars had been there from history right throughout, and it is inhuman, we all know. And since the Cold War, arm race had been going, and regional superiority complex had been always the case, and it will keep on going. I would like to know, as organizations, all what we are now trying to get together, what is the roadmap that we are planning, and how influenced are we to risk factor that is already, it is very sensitive. I know it is very sensitive. How much of impact that we can do to make a change or realization to bring?
Thank you, Kumudu. Nice to hear you after a long time. So now we can another participant can take the floor.
Can you hear me?
Yes, Romina. You can. Okay. We can hear you.
Yeah. Okay. If I can talk about the previous call. Question about Iran nuclear exchange with the Taliban, but also I'd like to, like other speakers, we talk about what we do.
Comrade Romina, can yes. you? Shall we take another 2-3 questions, and then you can answer selectively. You do not want to answer all the questions, but let's allow them to post another 2-3 questions, and this then we can finalize this session also. So just give us 2-3 minutes, and then I will come back to you. If anyone wants to make a comment or question from the experts.
I think there is no any question, Comrade Bimal.
Yes. So okay. Then we can continue. Please, Romina. Sorry for disturbing you. Now you can start. You have the floor.
It's all right. With a peace movement, normally what we do is we look at the situation, we look at who is doing what, and in terms of wars, we look at who is initiating wars, and it's been always the United States, and they always try to find an excuse or create a situation, and then they start attacking the government or the leaders of a country that they dislike, and they try to demonize them in the eyes of the public, so to get the support of the public behind them, and they will start attacking. So in Australia, I think I mentioned about an organization in Australia, ASPI, Australian Strategic Policy Institute. This organization was established in 2001. It gets all the funding, all the donations from military industrial complex, like Raytheon. And they all this military complex in the military industrial complex from the United States give this organization in Australia millions and millions of dollars, and its main job is to demonize China. And it works because a lot of people in Australia, they dislike Chinese people. They attack Chinese people in the streets. And so the main objectives of the government is established. They are quite happy now to go after China. When they talk about war with China, public doesn't say anything because it's already been demonized and it's been portrayed in the minds of the people that it is bad. So we have to look after ourselves because it's danger and we have to attack it. With Iran, it's been the same. For years and years, it's been under sanctions. Iran has always said they would never, because of their religion, they would never use nuclear arms. They use nuclear for electricity, for the natural use of what they need, but not for war, not for nuclear weapons. So, and we have to look again what is happening with Iran. How many times Israel has been campaigning to get the support of the United States to attack Iran? How many times Israel has been attacking Iran? So in the eyes of people, Iran is portrayed that it is bad, it is working with Taliban, all the organization, all this terrorist organization that it's been funded and supported and trained by the United States. So we need really to have a look at reality and see what is happening. In the same, again, I'll go back to China. It's been portrayed that China attacks minority people in their country, like Tibetan. For years, China had one child policy. But when it comes to minority, they were always allowed to have two children because China thought, well, they are minority, they need to increase their population. So we need to really have a look at what is the situation with wars. It's they lie. It's always about lie to the public, and they go to war. We've seen it with Iraq, Syria, Afghanistan. We've seen what it has happened. United States claims that they want to bring freedom and democracy to the people that they attack. Now, have we seen anything apart from destruction, killing? And people are homeless in their own country. So what is this about democracy? Why should the United States take democracy to a country that they want to determine their own path? So they are the things that we need to have a look. Peace organizations, we've been campaigning against sanctions, against wars, and we look at who is promoting those wars. So thank you. I better stop. Thank you.
Okay. Any other panelists want to come in?
Very briefly, Bimal.
Yes, Comrade Harchand, you can.
I would just add a little what my friend about Iran has said. I think that this is the false propaganda created by Israel and Trump since last many years against Iran. So look at the face of it. It is the nuclear technology is not just some assault rifles, machine guns, or even tanks that you can just send across the border. It is a sensitive technology. It needs very, very big infrastructure. It needs years, decades to have that infrastructure. And this kind of transfer, it is impossible that Iran can send it to Taliban or some other thing. In fact, this is continuing propaganda by Israel. Israel, who is the only nuclear power in this region and is a danger for all the other countries around it. And America is supporting Israel, sending them technologies, they're transferring the technology, helping them for having sophisticated weapons, this nuclear technology, et cetera, et cetera. So this kind of propaganda, we should be very careful. Secondly, one of my friend has said, what is the roadmap for working for peace and this thing? I think it is a very interesting thing and a very important job. And I can say it's a challenge. for all the peace-loving forces, democratic forces, and the progressive forces. They should try to win as much as possible support in their own countries and also having a cooperation at international level with such like-minded organizations and put pressure on their governments, on the international organizations like United Nations system and other agencies, that such kind of mad race for arms in this region, or let us say around the world, should be checked and should be stopped. This will be very important to have first public opinion to aware them the dangers for this mad arms race and which an other military alliance is being floated in this our region. So that is a very important task for us. Second, one friend has asked about French, because they have lost this big contract. And in fact, not only France, the countries, the regional supporters of the United States, like India, the right-wing government, you all know we have, they are claiming that they are very close with the American governments. And similarly, Japan, Indonesia, Malaysia, they all are saying, even South Korea, they all felt cheated because they were not consulted, they were not informed, they were not even discussed about this. It is a unilateral English-speaking or English racist, this alliance led by America and only around them. So there would be in future contradictions, and French and other important European countries, they can play an important role. Now we know that they are in NATO, they have limitations and so on, so on. But it has hurted them. And of course, they will try to get around them and try to damage this alliance. And this can also be used. These contradictions, whatever minor or major contradictions are there, they can be used for promoting our peace movement and against such military alliances. I thank you once again.
Comrade Bimal, I think I need to speak for 1 minute.
Yeah. Okay, comrade, 1 minute. Okay. Yes,
may I ask the panelists that is it a American or Israeli? No, first of all, let me make it clear that we communists are not American lovers. Okay, first of all. Second, the question is it a propaganda that China, Iran, and Taliban, they are coming into a close alliance between themselves? The third question is that we all know that it is a question of imperialist war, the war is not between the people and the imperialist forces. The war is between the different kind of imperialist forces. It is a result of imperialist contradiction. So if US, UK and Australia is a imperialist force, we all know that they are alliance, then the other imperialist force must be someone. It can't be a democratic country, and Iran is not a democratic country. Taliban are not democratic. China is not democratic too. So the other lobbies must be this kind of forces. And so we can't take sides when the issue is war. When this issue is war, and one of our comrade panelists said that we take sides issue to issue. But this issue to today's discussion is on war. And it's an imperialist war. And China, Taliban, and the Iran is taking up a particular side. They are an ally. So we can't side for any of the imperialist forces. We are against imperialism and war.
Okay, comrade. Thank you for your questions. I think now we have reached the end of our Q&A session, but I think that our panelists may want to add some points to the last questions raised. As well as I would like to focus our friend Kumudu, I think pointed a very good question, that what can be done by the people? What is to be done? So I would ask from the panelists to make the final remarks. If it is possible to answer the already raised questions and focusing on this AUKUS and what can be done, what people can do, not the politicians, not the big people, big leaders, but as general masses, what we can do, what is your experience says, what people can do. So I think with your final remarks on AUKUS and the questions, I would like the panelists to respond. Yes.
Bimal, I think I agree to the comrade's remarks to some extent. But sometimes we need to agree on disagreements because everybody have its own perception, its own view, its own way of analyzing the issues. As far as this Taliban is concerned, or the Iran, their alliance, or whatever our friend has said. Of course, if we see the history of Taliban, these are not created by China. These are not created by Iran. They were created by United States itself when there was Soviet army was in Afghanistan to fight against those army people. So then when these Talibans did something against America, then they came, the American army came them and fought against them and stayed there in Afghanistan. And for 20 years, they created such an atmosphere that they are occupying force. And the Taliban was as such treated like people that they are the force people who are unfortunately, they were fighting against the occupying forces. So this kind of things has happened. Now the question is here now. Now, how to tackle with the Taliban diplomatically? Can we ignore the developments in Afghanistan? It is a very strategic country. It is very rich with the natural resources. And you have to deal. There is no other way how to deal diplomatically. Americans, of course, they cannot do anything. They are get embraced and they are out. Now, there are two major forces, including India also, but India is not at the same par as China and Russia. They are, because it is directly affecting them. And they have to have some kind of strategy, some kind of diplomatic way to deal with such situation where this country is now standing. If this situation will further explode, it will have dangerous consequences, not only for Afghanistan, but the entire region. So this is a very sensitive question and has to be dealt diplomatically and sensitively. And I think they are trying to engage with them. You cannot put just saying them, those are enemies and we will not leave. They're now, we like or we don't like, they are governing one country. Very sensitive country in the strategic level. So maybe we have a different approach on it. Let us respect on this. I'm not concluding that only I'm right. Let us, this chapter will be open and history will show that how the things will turn in future. That is what I want to say, not saying somebody that is the wrong, not saying that I'm the right person or saying correctly, but this is the fact that Iran, no doubt, there is a dictatorship. There is progressive, many progressive people in the communist. They were eliminated in Iran after the so-called Islamic revolution. There is no doubt in this thing. And we may have also different approach about China and the internal things, so and so. But the fact remains that Iran is there now, and while we are dealing with this region, the Israel is the most weaponized and powerful country in the region. And they want to eliminate all the opponents in the region. They want to have their own, how they are dealing with the Palestinian. Yesterday also there was missiles they were sending in Syria. Every once or twice a week they are sending again. And all these things are there. So we have to be very logical and have to see the things very, very in broader way, how the things are here and what is the all the background of these things. So with these words, I thank you very much.
Okay, I would like to ask Comrade Ajamu to make his final remarks and comments. And I would like if you can focus on AUKUS pact as well as the proposal and the question made by Kumudu that what can be done by the people.
Thank you, comrade. Let me repeat or say again, emphasize the importance of these kinds of conversations, especially as they move toward a discussion around what popular forces need to do in order to reverse the kind of aggression that is being generated coming from very, very specific sources. As one comrade just reminded us of, that there's no equalization in terms of the threats facing humanity. We have to make determinations in terms of what objectively is unfolding and where we prioritize our limited resources and energy. And it's quite clear that we understand where the greatest threats to humanity are emerging from. So what do? It's quite clear we have to build a stronger global anti-imperialist movement with structures of accountability and cooperation. We have to concentrate our efforts, and we have to engage in, as I indicated in my comments, clear ideological struggle to delegitimize the justifications that imperialism will attempt to use to garner support for its anti-people's positions. We should, I think, examine very critically the potential weapon of struggling for zones of peace. In Asia, we are moving to develop, to support the declaration by the community of Latin America and Caribbean countries in the Americas from 2014 to declare the Americas a zone of peace. We're engaged in conversations with forces on the African continent to do the same. We think that this is a potential weapon that can be used because people want peace, they want development, and the continued militarization, wars, destruction is something that the people are clearly turning away from in the context of this ongoing deepening global crisis. So I think these are some of the broad things we can begin to consider. Now that we have an opportunity to travel again soon, I think we need to put back on the table some of the, I think, fantastic plans that the World Peace Council had to bring us together in an anti-imperialist formation or conference. And I think we need to begin to move toward realizing these kinds of objectives because we have, I think, a marvelous opportunity to advance our anti-war and anti-imperialist forces in the midst of this crisis. So thank you again for inviting us, and we hope that we can follow up and continue building toward a new world. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade, for accepting our invitation at the 11th hour, and thank you for your contribution. Comrade Romina, you want to make some comments and final remarks?
Yes, thank you. I think there are two things in war and peace. Those who are in war, they lie about it, and we know that they go to war with lies. So peace organizations, peace movement through this like Zoom and gathering, we need to expose those lies, and we talk about peace and promote peace and speak with as many people as we can, get the community behind peace movement, and then we can, hopefully we can one day end wars, but we have to have people behind peace movement. Thank you.
Thank you, Comrade. Comrade Iraklis?
Yes, Comrade Bimal, comrades.
Yes.
First of all, I want to make a
to state our appreciation for the whole discussion, for the initiative, as I said in the beginning, but also for the discussion. And I think that we are all gaining and winning from discussion, arguments, aspects, and enriching also our horizons, because as correctly said by my comrade Harchand Singh from IPSO India, nobody can claim that he has the absolute truth. Neither do we so in the world discourse. The anti-imperialist approach and principles and orientation of the World Peace Council is manifested for more than 7 decades. When, in the moment, around the end of the last century, this was in danger, the anti-imperialist line, the anti-imperialist approach. In 1999 in particular, I'm raising this example in order to explain our view. During the imperialist NATO aggression against the peoples of Yugoslavia, the Federal Republic of Yugoslavia, there were forces in the global peace movement which were saying, this leader, this ruler in Yugoslavia is bad, is committing crimes against the peoples and against minorities, and therefore welcoming the NATO bombing, which was clear a plan, and actually it was the precedent case for all the later crimes, because it was a 78 days bombing of Yugoslavia for the dismemberment of the whole Yugoslavia and the Balkans. We saw later much better the consequences, but the forces, even in the broader peace movement and also some few in the World Peace Council who raised those issues were not understanding that the World Peace Council was not taking sides in the sense of this or that government, but taking a clear anti-imperialist, anti-NATO, which is our DNA. World Peace Council and NATO were founded in the same year, and the World Peace Council can never accept any pretext or any, argument for any NATO intervention. I raised the same thing when I spoke about the South China Sea and the role of the US. Whatever disputes or violation of international norms and international law are being committed in the South China Sea, we can never accept that the US will come as an arbitrary court or a mediator to help any of the people. So the US is pushing through its own plans and using this situation in order to get stronger in the South China Sea and in the entire world. Therefore, when it comes to principles, we have to repeat and underline that the World Peace Council, wherever the just causes of the peoples are at stake and in danger, we will not spare any effort and any condemnation and a clear position, regardless to whom it has to be addressed. So if, and I mentioned the example of Libya as a clear one, and if countries and states, governments, which are not the principal ally of the World Peace Council, is the people's movements and the peace-loving forces and the organized peace movement, but where countries and states coincide with their political actions, with the needs, the desires, and the rights of the peoples, it's okay. But where the countries in the form of governments and states are not fulfilling, not complying to this, to the founding principles of the UN, for example, to the rights and needs of the peoples, we will criticize heavily and we will condemn. And this differentiates us from so-called NGOs, which are receiving money and funding from governments, playing the role of those governments, often powerful governments, playing the card of this or that imperialist center. So we are not choosing imperialists. We are not choosing amongst the enemies of peace. And this is the definition of the anti-imperialist struggle. I don't want to add more. I want to say just the last sentence, that by organizing the people, by getting more strong in each country and coordinating our efforts on regional level and national level, the enemies of peace, the imperialist system internationally, will get weaker. When we fight in each country, which is member state of NATO, to withdraw and to disengage from NATO, NATO will get weaker. So this means that at the same time, we fight inside each country for against the forces which are with NATO and with the Euro-Atlantic alliances, particularly in my continent, in Europe. And this is a contribution to the global struggle, and this helps the people of Palestine, the people of Syria, and the peoples in need today. Thank you.
Thank you, comrade. Iraklis, so now we have reached the end of our successful informative webinar. I think I can directly express it in that way. So now it's my duty to present a vote of thanks to all the contributors. On behalf of the PASOS, we would like to extend our sincere thanks to our four main panelists, Comrade Iraklis, Comrade Romina, Comrade Harchand, and Comrade Ajamu, for their sharp explanations and analysis of this new AUKUS pact, and not only that, actually, and other tools, other tactics, and strategies employed by the imperialists. I think you all of four panelists gave the lens, actually, how to analyze these very complex national and international developments. And here I would like to make a special thanks to Comrade Iraklis for assisting PASOS to bring these expert panelists to this webinar. So thank you, Comrade. And then other peace organizations of the world who had sent their messages and for their participation in this webinar. And I would like to thank our all participants for their participation and the wonderful interaction and for their moral support for this task, which encouraged us for sure. And finally, I would like to especially thank the comrade who produced the short video presentation on AUKUS, and other comrades who helped by doing artworks, making social media posts, and hosting the program. So on behalf of PASOS, I would like to thank for them also. So now we have to conclude our webinar. So let's work to build a world of peace, no to war, just to peace. Thank you, comrades. Have a nice day.
All the best. All the best.
Thank you. All power to the people.
All power to the people.
Care. I'm not.